Welcome to NTAC 2014.
This year's theme is Agents of Impact. How many of you have your glasses that were in the seats? Take a moment and put them on for me. Let's take a picture. Now, we love taking pictures. Mm-hmm. Are we ready? The camera's up front, right here. We'll take a couple. Come on. Couple of selfies. You can take some selfies of yourself and then tweet it out. Let's see. Got it? Awesome, great. Now we really plan on exposing all of you secret agents.
The truth is, you are all doing great work, and it's time to let the world know the impact that you have on your students, your colleagues, your communities, and the future.
The following 3 days will be filled on learning pathways focused on impacting leadership, culture, partnerships, and outcomes. Also, new this year, we're offering unconference topics. So, on your app, if you search for unconference, you'll find a multitude of topics, and we want you to go into those sessions and make them your own. So search for unconference on your app. Another thing is on Friday, we're offering institutes. Please be sure to register for those great topics for institutes.
This year, we welcomed our new schools as well as over 700 new teachers to the conference. We hope that as you challenge yourself this week, you also take the time to challenge yourself and your colleagues throughout the year. It's time to reveal our inner agents.
We are excited to introduce to you Matthew Swinson and Kimberly Weaver, our NTAC 2014 keynote speakers from Cross County High School. Kimberly specializes in art and Matthew specializes in philosophy. Please join me in welcoming the 2014 NTAC keynote speakers to the stage.
Only 2 minutes left until showtime. Hashtag nervous.
Yeah, it is pretty nice. I mean, NTAC does it right. I do wonder, though, if they could bring us some snacks. Hashtag M&Ms. Hashtag Snickers. Hashtag
How can you be thinking of eating at a time like this? Hashtag so nervous. Hashtag palms are sweaty. Hashtag M&M.
You're nervous? No. There's no reason to be nervous. Hashtag NTAC 14. Hashtag nobody comes to this thing.
It's hashtag NTAC 14. Everybody comes to these things. There are 1,500 educators out there waiting for us to come out there and be the hashtag keynote.
Hashtag silly girl. There are 15 educators out there. Hashtag elementary math.
Hashtag get your prescription changed. Hashtag lens crafters. There are 2 zeros after that 15, and they are all out there waiting for us. Hashtag my peers. Hashtag people I admire. Hashtag educational crushes.
Is that why they put it in the ballroom? Okay. Well, we'll be fine, I'm sure. 1,500 people. Why didn't we rehearse?
We had a lot of rehearsals. Why didn't you show up to rehearsals? Hashtag practice makes perfect.
Well, hashtag Game of Thrones. Hashtag season 3. Hashtag red wedding. Hashtag spoiler.
I managed to come to all the rehearsals and I watched hashtag Orange is the New Black season 2. Hashtag crazy eyes. Hashtag drop it like it's hot.
Hashtag drop it like it's hot?
Yeah, absolutely. Hashtag Hashtag Snoop Dogg. Hashtag actually Snoop Lion. Hashtag I really, really like lions. Hashtag they've got a lot of fur around them. Hashtag we're getting off subject. Hashtag you really, really need to practice.
Yeah, okay. We can do this. So let's get some note cards together. We can do this. I have a feeling that this is possible.
Hashtag we can't stop.
Hashtag we won't stop. Right. Hashtag Grammys.
We've got to get ready to do this. Hashtag this girl is on fire.
Hashtag someone should put her out.
Yo, teachers. Hashtag show time.
Hashtag Agents for Impact.
Hashtag Intact 14.
Hashtag this is how we do.
Hashtag wardrobe change.
Hashtag let's do this.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Matthew Swinson and Kimberly Weaver.
So there are people out here. All right.
Welcome everyone to Intact 2014. We are so excited to be with y'all today.
Kim and I just finished our second year of teaching, which makes us highly underqualified to be the keynote speaker at this conference.
But we're not going to focus on that. Instead, we hope to entertain, inspire, and excite.
I'm really focused on not vomiting, passing out, or going viral on YouTube.
But
great, they're laughing at my insecurities already.
I know. It really is time we should probably get focused. We should probably introduce ourselves. My name is Kimberly Weaver. I teach 7th or 12th grade art and an English art co-taught class at Cross County High School and New Tech School in Cherry Valley, Arkansas. I'm originally from the great state of Montana, and I have a dream to one day see a New Tech school in Big Sky Country.
My name is Matthew Swenson. I have been a professional bodybuilder for the last 10 years, obviously. But in all reality, I also teach at Cross County High School, where I teach philosophy and am the director of our high school writing center.
So you may have the question, what is this keynote going to be about?
Sure do. Folks, it's kind of embarrassing, but we got no plan.
This is actually really choreographed.
No plan at all, folks.
We've been working on this since, like, March.
Oh, wait. Weaver, the theme of this conference is Agents for Impact. We could probably do something with that, like a little improv speech.
What a novel idea. That sounds great. Let's do it.
Well, then, it's morphin time.
It's morphin time!
Art teacher!
Philosophy teacher! We gotta give a good speech!
Come on, Spencer, we can do it! Supposed to be on some sort of stage?
Go, go, Power Rangers!
Nothing like a 90s reference to exemplify relevance and innovation.
Just like the Power Rangers.
Notice that force tie in there.
We make millions of impacts every day in our lives, and it all starts on our drive to work as we're passing people on the highway.
The person that we buy our coffee from at Starbucks.
We make impacts with our staff and faculty at our school site.
And especially our students. And all those impacts add up.
And eventually, they shape the world around us.
As educators, we make more impacts than the average person. So the question is, how do we make as many of those impacts positive as possible?
And to go further, how do we match our goals with our impacts? As educators, we're often focused on goals.
It's kind of what we do.
So how do our impacts relate to each other? And what's the big question? How do our goals relate to our impacts? And what is our overall goal in education?
Well, we want our students to be college and career ready.
We want students who can collaborate with each other.
We want students who can speak in front of a large audience.
Do I need to say more?
We want students who can innovate.
And we want students who can solve real-world problems.
But it's important to note that while all these are essential, they're just a means to an end. Our true mission, our true aim is towards happiness. And happiness is often defined differently than how we're going to be using it here today.
We are going to use happiness as Aristotle did in ancient Greece. Aristotle thought that happiness was best described as the good life or human flourishing. Eudaimonia in Greek.
Great, everybody. Swenson with the Greek definition.
You see, Aristotle thought that happiness was the meaning of life, but it wasn't about being smiley or energetic. It was about looking at the entirety of someone's life and objectively being able to say, yeah, they had a good life. So that's how we're going to use happiness today, the good life. Eudaimonia.
Today we're going to take you on a series of catalysts. We are going to talk about joy, curiosity, anger, creativity, and passion. We're going to talk about how each of those can bring us to a new level of happiness.
And as I look into this crowd, I can tell this is going to go down as the great meeting of the minds.
Are you stealing all your ideas from people that are smarter than you?
Yeah, always. It's kind of a personal policy.
Well, let's get back to the big picture.
All jokes aside, we're very excited to be here to introduce the next couple of days. NTech this year has been designed to revitalize and refresh. This conference, this presentation, is an opportunity for you to reflect and get excited for your work ahead.
We're here to share and spark ideas within you. We hope that today you'll walk out with a new perspective on the work that you do, that we do to make a difference in our students' lives.
But if you haven't figured it out already, this presentation is a bit different. We're gonna need your help because we're gonna ask you to participate both digitally and physically. So be ready.
And for all of those on Twitter, please, please, please send us all your love and pictures and all that stuff using the hashtag #NTech14.
Are we ready?
I think we're ready to go.
All right. Jubilation.
Glee.
Ecstasy.
Elation.
Euphoria.
Joy.
Joy. A lot of people think that joy and happiness are the same thing.
But really, joy is just one of the catalysts that can launch us into happiness.
Professor Brent Robinson described it best. He said that joy on the one hand was relaxed serenity, and the other elation. And when he asked people about joy, they fell somewhere on that continuum. Some people really enjoy being at home by a campfire, relaxed and at peace.
Other people think of joy as that buildup in tension, that winning touchdown at the Super Bowl, or you're walking with your boyfriend and suddenly he proposes. Not that I know what that feels like. All my single ladies in the room? But there's that moment, and then boom, the surprise, there's elation. You're not thinking about the past or what's coming up next. You're completely in that present moment.
And we have the ability as educators to bring joy to our schools, to our classrooms, to our lives, and to the lives of our students.
Now, we know what you're thinking. These young, crazy, energetic people are gonna get up here and spend the next 40 minutes talking to you about how joy is an important element to have in your classroom. Not like you already have content standards and, you know, how about your own life to think about.
But that's not what we're here to do. We're not here to make you feel bad about your current classroom or make you have added stress or pressure. We think that new tech classrooms already are set up for joy. Many of us have joy moments in our classroom. And if not, we can easily put them into what we already do.
And as PBL educators, new tech teachers are the perfect example for what Professor Robbins is talking about. We can have those moments of joy where students are thinking, engaging, exploring, and then boom, revelation.
Oh, this is that moment where I forgot my line. Oh, great, there's the photo, that will help me. So what we're trying to say is that joy is a known catalyst to happiness, and you don't have to be as energetic as this kid. Though if you want to be, you can. But the more moments in our school sites where kids are engaged and excited, the better chance we have of getting them towards happiness.
We can put those moments in our project that have that boom effect. And for me, I have a little confession.
You have a confession?
Yeah, I'm kind of nervous.
Okay.
Really, I don't think I can do this anymore.
No, the speech is going fine. The one guy's sleeping, but besides that, everyone else looks like they're... Some people are laughing, it's fine.
It's not that. I actually feel okay about it. You already messed up. So, I have a slight confession to make, though. I kind of filmed your classroom a couple months back, and the students really wanted me to play it here today, and I know it's just kind of mean now that there's like actually real people here.
Well, I'm sure it's an example of a moment of joy. We should play it. No, we should play it.
Okay.
In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the, anyone? The Great Depression, passed the, anyone? A tariff bill, the Hawley-Smoot Tariff Act, which anyone raised or lowered? Raised tariffs in an effort to collect more revenue for the federal government. Did it work? Anyone? Anyone know the effects? It did not work, and the United States sank deeper into the Great Depression.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't even think that made it onto the rubric.
Yeah, but you know, I actually also got a video of us when we did that cross-curricular project last year. Maybe we should show that one.
All right, just show it.
Wow.
We really love Nintendo 64. Though I do have a few questions. Number one, if we're co-teaching a class, why are we in someone's living room in our pajamas? And number two, why do we look like we're 10 years old?
The point is, you don't have to be the really boring guy or the super, super excited preteen. Now you can just be you, and you can find how those moments fit in your project for yourself. And right now, for me, this is kind of a boom being the present moment.
Before we begin this activity, it's important that you know a little bit of science behind it.
Always.
So in our research for this presentation, we found that human contact, even for a few moments, raises your joy levels. So we are going to connect this entire room in a moment of joy.
It's called Massively Multiplayer Thumb Wrestling.
Educators, please listen to the instructions on your screens.
We are about to embark on a moment of joy that will connect this entire room.
We're about to play
Massively Multiplayer Thumb Wrestling.
Everyone knows the way we thumb wrestled when we were kids. 1, 2, 3, 4. I declare a thumb war. But in
Massively Multiplayer Thumb Wrestling,
you will play in groups of 3 to 4 per hand. Listen closely for the following instructions.
Step 1.
The first step is to stand up and find 3 or 4 neighbors. You're going to connect just like the video shows.
Step 2.
Once you fill up your first hand, you'll want to take your other hand and find 3 to 4 more neighbors to connect with.
Step 3.
After you've connected with both your hands, you'll want to wait until we say go. We want to connect the entire room before we begin.
Step 4.
After we say go, you'll begin the battle with both your hands. But to win, you cannot simply sit there and let others fight. To win, you must be the first to get someone else's thumb down. Remember, to win, be the first. And that is how you play
Massively Multiplayer Thumb Wrestling.
Now that we have our directions, we're going to get started in just a moment.
Just like the video showed you, you're going to play with the people around you. If you weren't paying attention, we know how that is sometimes, there's instructions on the screen. Let's stand up and do it.
All right, we need everybody to stand up, and we're going to first connect together before we all start. So you want to make sure you get somebody for each hand.
If you have an open thumb, raise your hand so someone connects it.
Find another thumb. We're going to get everybody connected up together. All right. We're getting there. We've got some open thumbs right here. Let's get connected.
Remember to connect with both hands. Okay, quiet.
All right. We're gonna begin in just a moment. We know you're all teachers and you know how to be quiet. Maybe not. Maybe they don't.
Okay.
Ready?
Yeah. We're gonna count down together. Listen up and then you're gonna play. Wait for the countdown.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1,
play! Have a seat, folks, have a seat.
Did we have a moment
I know, we've been doing this with an empty, like, chairs, and no one said anything when we asked that question. Did we feel it? Joy. Catalyst number one. It's something that we can add to our classrooms and to our schools as we all strive towards the good life.
The important thing is to not stop questioning. Curiosity has its own reason for existing. Albert Einstein.
Curiosity is the lust of the mind. Thomas Hobbes.
Children are remarkable for their intelligence and ardor, for their curiosity, their intolerance of shames, the clarity and ruthlessness of their vision. Aldous Huxley.
Curiosity killed the cat. Some random person.
That's not exactly what we were going for here.
Actually, it kind of fits perfectly now that I think about it.
Wait, are you going off script? You've already messed up once.
No, well, I don't know if you know, but many in ancient Greece, including many in Aristotle's time, thought curiosity was a bad thing because it challenged traditional philosophical belief. They thought they had it all figured out and that to challenge that would lead to negative consequences.
So tradition was being held on a pedestal. Sounds like Aristotle had a lot of the same problems that we have today.
Now who's forcing the connection?
The point is, what Aristotle said is that curiosity matters.
And as human beings, being social and rational creatures, we need to maximize our social and rational sides. And that means being curious.
Now, leaving the cats out of this, and note that no cats were harmed during the making of this presentation, we are both really big cat people. Curiosity is important because it fosters a growth, innovation, and a love for wisdom.
Curiosity matters, and it matters what our students are curious about.
So let's dig a little deeper into what curiosity looks like.
Take a look.
Well, if I was lost, I suppose it would be good advice to stay where I was. But who would ever think to look for me here? Curiouser and curiouser.
Yet can curiosity be taught?
I don't know, sir. Who are you, sir?
I am the great Aristotle from ancient Greece, young Alice. I have come to ask you a question. What is the meaning of life?
Well, I don't know, sir.
Like a knife's meaning is to cut, the meaning of life for a human is to reason or to think. And only when we are truly engrossed in thinking will we find our real purpose. And the only way there is through curiosity.
But, sir, I often find that curiosity leads me to trouble.
Trouble, my Alice. Trouble indeed. But only through trouble can great things be done.
Curiouser and curiouser indeed. Excuse me, miss. Did you see that man? That's Aristotle.
No, honey, that's just a man in a sheet.
Wow, that was some rare footage of Aristotle. And that's kind of what the end of my career looks like. But he is a very handsome man, well-dressed, skinnier than I thought he would be.
As we saw in the video, Alice thought that curiosity often led to trouble. But as Aristotle so wisely stated, only through trouble can great things be done.
Catalyst number two, curiosity. We want to be curious as we explore the world, and we want the same for our students.
Whoa! Darkness!
Can hear it knocking on my door. I cover my ears and run. Can't take it anymore, just wishing it was done. Can feel it creeping up on you. I shiver and try to hide. But now I know it can see. It is right there on my side. Can smell its rotten breath. I close my eyes. Inside there is only death. Out there, I roll the dice. can see it coming close to me. I am screaming silently. The fight I cannot win. The darkness is consuming me. Anger.
Emotions are often seen as negative, especially anger. It's something that we hear that it needs to be managed or controlled. It's something we would rather have none of than some of. At least that's how it's often spoken about.
But wait, are we doing this right? Because why would we include anger in a presentation about happiness?
Because believe it or not, there's a lot of anger in our profession. There's a lot of dark places in our work. Policies, standards, mandates, accountability, and that's just for us as educators. Think of how our students feel. They feel similar things when it comes to their schoolwork.
I do love Austin Powers. $1 million. And we express our anger in a variety of ways. One way is that we tweet about it on the Twitterverse.
Swenson doesn't actually know what a Twitterverse is, but let's look at these tweets.
Dear Monday, go step on a Lego?
Our English teacher speaks in old English. Hashtag MTree props.
For pleasure, she's reading Art of Coaching. For professional, she's reading Game of Thrones to learn how to vanquish her enemies. Hashtag PBL chat.
I made a new friend at my workshop today, which was the nicest thing I can say about it. Hashtag teacher problems.
Meeting with my kid's principal today. This should go well. Hashtag not.
I hate how you're just born, forced to get an education and get a job. What if I wanted to be a duck? Why would you want to be a duck?
Honestly, anyone could be an English teacher. Give kids a book, say why to everything they say about it, and then tell them their essay sucks.
I really hate when we're going into exams and teachers don't tell me what my grade is. Seriously?
I hope that right now some cocky eighth grader at the school is writing an editorial about how much that principal sucks.
Not always happy with education, and like these tweets show, anger can spread really quickly.
But the question we have to ask ourselves is, how do we use anger to motivate us? How do we ensure that anger is a tool and doesn't become our enemy?
We can't bottle it up. We need to use it to move us to a positive place. And we need to do the same for our students since they feel those similar struggles. And our students know it when we're angry.
The best way to use our anger is to try to achieve our goals. The best remedy to anger is success in our aims.
We have to address it directly. We can't let anger cloud us. We need to use its energies to drive us.
And as good agents for impact, we have to model that for our students. So when they're in similar situations, they know how to handle themselves.
Now there's a lot of things in this world that we can be angry about, big or small. Currently right now I'm a little irritated that J-Lo's decided her new dance move is I Love You Papi. What is that? What happened to Jenny on the block? But whatever it is that makes you angry, we have to learn how to constructively solve problems using our passion.
Anger, catalyst number 3. It's not always a bad thing. It has the potential to be extremely powerful.
And one of those ways that anger can be used to be extremely powerful is when it's fueled through creativity.
Oh yeah, creativity. I love creativity. I gotta tell you, one of the most creative movies I've ever seen, what's it called? Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Okay, you know that was a book, right? Charlie and the Chocolate Factory?
Yeah, I don't need all your reading. What I'm talking about is Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. You know, the most creative scene is when they first walk in to that chocolate factory.
So please tell me you're talking about the one and only Wonka film.
Yeah, I'm not some loser. I'm talking about Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory with Gene Wilder. You know, the original Hunger Games? Didn't know if that was gonna get a laugh. All right.
Glad it did. You know, now that there's all this laughing, I really think we probably should have made a parody video about, you know, Willy Wonka and creativity in our classroom.
I'm sensing the sarcasm. We have a video, right?
We definitely do.
All right.
Hold your breath. Make a wish. Count to three.
Come with me, and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look, and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin, traveling in the world of my creation. What we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world? There's nothing to it.
Gene Wilder portrayed Willy Wonka in the 1971 film Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. When he read the script, he loved it, but he had one stipulation for agreeing to play the character. He wanted to be able to walk out in that first scene with a cane in hand and be hobbling along and have it get stuck in the cobblestone, but he would keep walking a few more steps and then realize that he left the cane behind, and so he would stumble forward, but then he'd go into a somersault and bound up to the roaring crowd in awe. He stated that he wanted to do this because from that time on, no one will know if I'm lying or telling the truth.
And for those of you who have seen Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, you know how important that scene is. And if the director did not allow Gene Wilder to be creative in that moment, it wouldn't have been part of the film. Willy Wonka famously stated, "We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams." And that reigns true in our work as educators and our students' work on their educational journey. We are the music makers. We are the dreamers of dreams.
And we have the ability to put these creative moments into our classroom, but a lot of the times, they're forgotten.
Often, we do the same thing because that's how it's always been done.
Raise your hand if you've heard that one before. Yeah, we see some people out there.
And we have the opportunity to bring creativity in every one of our classrooms and into our students' lives.
I hear a lot about what creativity is or isn't being in the art room. Sometimes people think just by being in the room, they're going to be more creative. But that's not the case. Being creative is all about opening your mind to new possibilities.
Weaver, I think I have a story. This slide's telling me that.
Of course you do.
You know, back in Aristotle's time, they thought that the Earth was the center of the universe and that everything rotated around the stationary Earth. That held true for hundreds of years until creative and amazing thinkers of the scientific revolution proved that they were wrong. This whole time, we were hurling around the universe and nobody knew. I had this professor, Professor Carlin, who once told me, for something to be that monumental to happen today, it would literally have to blow our minds.
Like if aliens existed.
No, not at all. It would have to be like if cats existed. And, well, they do exist, so that's really weird.
That's good.
Has anyone seen a cat? Because that blew my mind. No, but what I'm trying to say is, it would have to be like if cats were intelligent life sent here to spy on us.
But no one would know if cats were intelligent life sent here to spy on us if no one thought outside the box.
If no one thought creatively.
Creative people like Gene Wilder, the great thinkers of the scientific revolution, and Ellen.
That's right, folks. She said Ellen from the Ellen DeGeneres Show.
Ellen is a creative thinker in what she does, especially when it comes to dance. She knows that dance is one of the best ways to express yourself and have a moment of joy and creativity.
And those of you who have seen the Ellen Show know that she dances with her audience on every episode. And that's what we're gonna do today. We're gonna dance. So listen carefully. This is how it's gonna work. In a minute, we're gonna stand up and we're gonna dance where we're at. And feel free to do any type of dancing that you feel appropriate.
Appropriate.
And it must be appropriate. Notice that word. Additionally, we will be doing Ellen-style selfies using hashtag NTechDance. You'll see it up on the screen, but we'd love to see your dance moves up on Twitter.
Are we ready?
I think we're ready.
I've been waiting.
Everybody,
for this part.
Stand up. We need y'all to stand up.
Let's go. Be ready to dance.
We're gonna fill this room with energy.
Ready?
DJ, hit it. Ba-da-da-da-da.
got nothing to lose. Make it move. Girl, you know what we came to do. Make no mistake. You're in the place to be by boss. Let's get crazy. Like we ain't never gonna see tomorrow. Come on, now are you comfortable?
Right there, right there. Let the groove get in. There, there, right there. Are you comfortable?
You go alone.
I know.
You just go alone.
Oh, did we get the selfie?
Did we feel the energy in the room?
Creativity, catalyst number 4.
It's something we want to bring to our school sites if it's not already there.
The final catalyst we are going to talk to you about today is passion.
Passion is something that drives all of us.
I want to shout out Brady Mullet from Eagle Tech Academy, who's right there because I just danced with him. He did an Ignite talk last year at InTech called Enough. And since then, I've watched it probably 10 or more times, and every time I get so fired up.
And you know, what drives us and what drives our students is what truly matters. If we're using our passions to drive us and what we do, then we're on the road to happiness.
And when we thought about passion and its role in the good life, we thought about those around us. So here's a video of those at our school.
I'm passionate about having fun.
I'm passionate about my kids and my grandbaby,
my family, and church.
Learning.
Grandchildren.
I am passionate about student and teacher success.
I'm passionate about FFA.
Learning.
Sleeping.
I'm passionate about food.
Singing.
Cheerleading.
I'm passionate about teaching Chinese.
Music.
Learning.
Singing.
Football. Jump rope.
Baseball. I'm passionate about going to college.
Football. Fishing.
Teamwork. Every time.
Student driven
learning. I'm passionate about friendship.
Football.
I'm passionate about cheerleading and school spirit. Go Birds!
Reading.
English.
About teaching agriculture.
High energy.
Family.
I'm passionate about baseball.
Anime.
Students, 365 days a year, day and night, I want to see a smile on their face.
I'm passionate about reading.
Family. My school and school grades.
Writing and art.
Students understanding science.
Opportunities.
I'm passionate about baseball.
Music.
Short films.
I'm passionate for basketball.
I'm passionate about art.
Instagram.
I'm passionate about reading.
This video does a great job of showing passion, but it's not always that easy. Finding your passion is a lifelong journey that a lot of the time just starts with school.
Our students need to know that they are going to have a lot of passions in their lifetime and that those are going to change and evolve over time. And that's okay. That's what it means to be a lifelong learner. And as long as they're letting their passions drive them, they're well on the way to a good life.
And it's important to know while on that way to finding your passion that you might fail. We know this because we've failed and we've learned from those failures.
We've been challenged and we've learned from those challenges.
It's imperative we model to our students that failure is acceptable as long as it's driving towards something.
And that's what we need to do in our work.
Randy Posh, in his book, The Last Lecture, wrote about brick walls. He stated that brick walls are only there for one simple reason, to keep out those who don't really want it.
And our students are going to have brick walls. And it's our job as educators to help them overcome some of those brick walls. But it's not easy, because it's going to be different for every student.
Now, no one ever said our job was easy. Okay, actually, a lot of people have said that our job was easy, and that's because they don't know what it's about and they don't have the passion for it.
But if we can get our students there to a place where they're ready and excited for a challenge and wanting more, then we are well on our way to setting them up for success.
And we think that the catalyst to determination is passion.
Passion. Catalyst number 5.
You see, Aristotle was right when he asserted that the good life is our aim.
We hope that this presentation has given you a taste of some of the catalysts that we think are important as we go towards the good life.
We wanted this presentation to be different. We wanted you to dance and thumb wrestle and interact. We wanted to give you something that you could take back to your community. We hope that this has been a primer for your week and for your work ahead.
But it's important to note that we're not experts. We, like you, at times fail, get mad, and struggle.
But we're on a journey towards the good life, and we want to find it, and we want our students to find it.
Remember, happiness is not all about having a big smile on your face, unless that's you, and that's fine. But it's about being who you are and finding a way to inspire from that place.
Joy.
Curiosity.
Anger.
Creativity.
Passion.
The good life.
Go find it.
Thank you.
Matthew and Kimberly, everybody.